anymore.
Okay, sorry about that.
Officials, I need a big smile over here.
He's gonna run me over, this guy.
Thanks for coming down.
Who are you?
I don't know. Who am I?
Senator Bayless, Harry Rock, how are you, buddy?
It's nice to meet you. Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Okay, next time, boots.
I am Gary Fontaine, your Master of Ceremonies, and on behalf of the City of Westfield and all our veterans, we want to thank you for coming to Westfield's annual Memorial Day Ceremony. Your officer of the day will be Keith Buckout of Westfield Marine Corps League Detachment 141, who will be in charge of all units during our ceremony. Guests, please rise. Remain standing through the presentation of our national colors and our national anthem. Officer of the day, take charge and put all units to attention.
Commanders, bring your units to attention. Present.
Thank you.
Now, I would like to bring up Richie Olekna, Chaplain of the American Legion, Post 124. Please come forward for the invocation.
Memorial Day is a federal holiday for mourning military personnel who have died while serving the United States Armed Forces. Let us pray. Almighty God, your hands are in the living and the dead. We give you thanks for all those, our comrades, who have laid down their lives in the service of our country. May they rest in peace, and may perpetual light shine upon them. May the good work of seeking justice for the oppressed and peace for all mankind be rewarded with success, that their sacrifices shall not have been in vain. And may we never fail to remember the cost of freedom we enjoy. All this we ask in your name. Amen.
Thank you, Richie. Guests, please be seated. Officer today, please put all units at rest.
Commanders, put your units at ease.
Memorial Day, formerly known as Decoration Day. It is a United States federal holiday observed annually on the last Monday of May. This year, we observe Memorial Day on Monday, May 29th, 2023. We continue to lose heroes every day in places like Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, and in military training accidents and missions around the world. From the American Revolution to the current operations against terrorism, millions of American men and women have made the supreme sacrifice while serving in wars and conflicts. We honor them all, not just those with the highest medals or the heroes who fought the most famous battles. They all died so we can continue to cherish the things we love: freedom, country, family. That is why we are gathered here on Memorial Day, to honor their memory. Godspeed to all. And now I would like to bring up Jillian Battles to read the governor's official Memorial Day proclamation. Jillian.
The Commonwealth of Massachusetts, a proclamation. Whereas, while the nation was still recovering from the horrors of the Civil War, people in cities and towns across the country gathered to honor those Union and Confederate soldiers who had given their lives, celebrating the first Decoration Day. And whereas, after World War I, the nation came together again to honor those who had fallen in the service of their country, renamed Memorial Day, the last Monday in May, is when people remember and honor the memory of all the men and women who fought and died in all American wars and conflicts. And whereas, throughout our country's history, thousands of Massachusetts citizens have fought in wars and conflicts to defend our safety and way of life. And whereas, throughout our their legacy of patriotism and dedication to country is an inspiration to all Americans. And whereas, it is appropriate that all Massachusetts citizens remember the bravery of those who gave their lives so that their sacrifices serve as a reminder of the cost of our freedom. Now, therefore, I, Maura T. Healy, Governor of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, do hereby proclaim May 29th, 2023, to be Memorial Day, and urge all the citizens of the Commonwealth to take cognizance of this event and participate fittingly in its observance.
Thank you very much, Jillian. And now I would like to introduce today's guest speaker, retired U.S. Army Lieutenant Colonel Kathy Martin, also a member of American Legion Post 124 Westfield.
Good morning. Good morning. As you just heard, I'm Kathy Martin. I was a Lieutenant Colonel in the United States Army as a Nurse Corps officer for 22 years on active duty. I was asked to be the guest speaker today as I am a Gulf War veteran. The original plan was to dedicate a monument to honor the veterans who passed during the Gulf War that belonged to Westfield. There were some delays in obtaining the arrival of the stone, so we have to change the dedication to Veterans Day later this year, so I would love everyone to please come to that in November. I would like to thank the Community Preservation Council of Westfield for funding this monument, as well as the Veterans Service Officer of the City of Westfield, Julie Barnes, for her work on this important project. On Memorial Day, we come together at ceremonies throughout communities to honor our fallen veterans. There is a time to mourn, however, we must praise these heroes who died in service to the United States of America and foreign lands to free the oppressed. We are eternally grateful for the selfless service of our fallen brothers and sisters who gave themselves completely to the cause of defending and protecting us all. We do not forget them. Whether it's been 1 hour or 1 century, remember that our sacrifice allows them to live on. I served in the Gulf War. On August 2nd of 1990, Iraq invaded Kuwait with armored divisions. I was one of the initial medical assets deployed to the theater, and by the middle of August, I was on the ground as part of an advance party, and I was stationed at the Royal Air Base in Dahran, Saudi Arabia, with the 82nd Airborne Division as part of the United States Rapid Deployment Force. By September 1990, my entire unit, which was entitled the 5th MASH, which is a mobile army surgical hospital, was in Saudi Arabia, and we were the first functional military hospital in the country. The 5th MASH ultimately moved forward 6 times during this operation. We were always the first to set up, we were the first to be functional, and the first to receive any injured or casualties. We were operationally attached to the 24th Infantry Division with a mission to provide far forward surgical care on the front lines to the combat units that were positioned to attack the western flank of the Iraq Army. As you recall, the major objective of the Gulf War was to prevent Iraqi forces from taking Saudi Arabia and its oil fields to control 40% of the world's oil reserves. The Iraqi army at the time was the 5th largest army in the world. They had 950,000 personnel, 10,000 armored vehicles, and 4,000 artillery pieces. The Iraqi air forces had 40,000 personnel and 689 combat aircraft. Iraq also had stockpiles of biological agents to include anthrax and nerve agents. They also had Soviet-made Scud surface-to-surface missiles mounted on mobile launchers. These had an effective range up to 185 miles and could carry a payload of conventional explosives as well as chemical or biological weapons. This was horrifying to me when I served over there on the day that they gave me shots and medications to help me mitigate the risk of exposure to these toxins. Many of us ladies were of childbearing ages when we deployed, and we were very concerned about our future babies. Over the next few months of the buildup, the United States carried out its largest overseas deployment since World War II. We sent over 560,000 troops. Additionally, numerous coalition forces also arrived in the theater. Unfortunately for medical units, the casualty rate estimates were about 20 to 30,000, which would have represented about 3,000 casualties per week. Fortunately, there were only 299 lives lost. It could have been a lot worse, and God rest those souls. 27 of these deaths occurred on 25th of February in 1991 when a Scud missile hit the barracks in Dahran, Saudi Arabia, where I was previously located. The deadline for Iraq to leave Kuwait was the 15th of January, 1991, and this did not happen. So we were going, actually, to war. This was really hard for me to wrap my head around. The first phase of the Gulf War was Desert Storm, which was the coalition air operations from 17 January to 24 February, 1991. So it lasted approximately 6 weeks. On January 20th, I was on Dahran Air Base, and during the Allied air offensive, a Scud missile was aimed at targets in Saudi Arabia on that very air base. The 5th MASH was located there, and for me, it was quite terrifying. We had to shelter in bunkers, or we had to stay in the hospital, which was made of tentage, and we had to kind of hunker down behind sandbags. That night, we had a patient that was too unstable to move into a bunker, so it was my turn to stay with him. Thankfully, the U.S. Patriot anti-ballistic missile defense system was very effective in interception of that Scud missile that was aimed towards us. We had no additional casualties that night, so we were really grateful. In 6 weeks, there were 116,000 air combat sorties, which dropped 85.5 tons of bombs over the Iraqi military. The second phase of the Gulf War was the ground operation. This was entitled Desert Saber. It took place from 24 to 28 February 1991. This is the part of the war where we had to pick up, move our hospital. We followed the 82nd and 101st Airborne Corps, and we also followed the 24th ID as we advanced into Iraq to the Euphrates. We set up the hospital in the dark, which was very difficult. We used flashlights and headlights, but the enemy, we had to be careful, they could see us. We were preparing for heavy casualties at that time as the units held this blocking position and other units were coming forward too. Fortunately for us, it only lasted 100 hours to liberate Kuwait and have the Iraqi army surrender. At this time, I was feeling extremely relieved. I was so thankful, and all I could was say, thank you, God, for not having a lot of wounded and dead. Let me be real. The whole time I was there, I was scared and frightened. I was in a foreign land. I was unsure of my immediate future. My family, they were freaked out the few times I was able to communicate them. They were seeing all kinds of reports on the news and didn't really have any concrete facts because they didn't really know exactly where I was. So the media was awesome to give information, but as a family member, I was told it was kind of frightening. We had a mission to accomplish. I was an American soldier and a warrior nurse, so we just did our job. We all take an oath when we serve to die for America if called upon. I took that oath and I swore to obey and serve my country and the military. I am so grateful that I physically did not die. Now I get to be here with this wonderful community in Westfield and all these amazing veterans and family members in our community. I did it, it was bigger than me, I never imagined it. I helped a lot of people when I was there, but I continue to help a lot of people as a nurse working at Bay State and as a Legionnaire as a member of Post 124. Ladies and gentlemen, freedom is not free. And thank you all veterans for your sacrifices. You gave your youth, your strength, your bravery. You gave your time and you did your job well. Many folks would not want to do this job, but you did it. You were and are exceptional. Veterans deserve our respect and always will. You are willing to sign on the dotted lines with your brothers and sisters at arms. We know your true suffering, sacrifice, and honor. To those who came back, we see you and honor you. We know you are forever changed by your experiences. I know this personally as my military experience, especially deployments, which there are many, not just Iraq, these forever changed and shaped the person who I am today. Some people die in combat, others physically live to make it home, like myself, and then they succumb to other wounds of war such as Agent Orange, Gulf War Syndrome, PTSD, suicide, traumatic brain injury, loss of limbs, hearing, and organs. So how do we as Americans pay respect to honor veterans, and how can I offer you some ideas to honor their sacrifice? So many years, I was kind of unaware of like what to do. I was just sort of floundering myself. So after I retired from the military, I somehow landed in Western Massachusetts, which is very endearing to me now. I met some people at the American Legion Post 124 here in Westfield, whose mission is to support and honor veterans, Many of our members are participating here today in the parade and the ceremony, as well as other veteran groups from the area. And I thank you all for coming and supporting your fellow veterans. Based on what I learned at the American Legion in Post 124 and attending numerous other city and veteran events, I pose a call to action on Americanism and veteran support with the purpose of remembering so that we don't let these lives go in vain. One, you can do a decorating of a grave. So every Memorial Day and Veterans Day, you will see the American Legion and other groups out there at St. Mary's and other cemeteries around Westfield, with Jean Thoreau and Gary leading the charge, and we're planting flags at veteran graves. You can also volunteer to help at Agawam Veterans Cemetery. They're always looking for volunteers to both help plant flags and remove them. You can fly an American flag, and there is a flag code and a protocol. So as you can see today, our flag is at half staff. You can tell a veteran that you appreciate them and their sacrifice, and you might be surprised, they might tell you some interesting stories. Number four is acknowledge a Gold Star family. This can be done by committing aid to widows, widowers, and orphans of fallen service members. I offer gratitude and condolences to the family for the death of their daughter and my colleague, Captain Gussie Jones from Arkansas. She was a United States Army Nurse Corps officer who died in Baghdad when she served as a registered nurse with the 31st Combat Support Hospital. Wear a poppy. I truly did have a poppy on when I started and I lost it. But thank you for Fred Benda for all the beautiful poppies and wreaths around the park today. So a poppy is a symbol of the lives lost and a reminder of living legacies. So when you see us out there at Dunkin' Donuts with our poppies, that's basically what we're trying to do. And we're actually trying to get some money so that we can give it back to local veterans. So that's number six, you can help local veterans, disabled and wounded. You can do this locally. What American Legion Post 124 does is we go to the soldiers' home in Holyoke and we do some activities with them, and we'll go out to the VA in Leeds, and we've done a few donations for them, and we even recently did a nice barbecue for them, and it was a big hit. The last big one is Be the One. So this is a big initiative from the American Legion and just in the United States in general. We want to intervene on people who are at risk for suicide, and veterans are on high on that list. So if anyone is in crisis and you see that, instead of calling 911 like you would do for a medical emergency, call 988 and you will get a counselor right on the phone, and you can help that veteran or get the veteran to a resource. So Ronald Reagan initially made this time of 3 o'clock for Memorial Day, and nobody really does a lot of the ceremonies then because everybody's at a cookout or a picnic. So the last thing that you can do is take your phones out sometime before you leave the park today. You can set your alarm for 3 o'clock and at that moment have a moment of silence and thank a veteran for their sacrifice. As President Bush said during his address at the end of the Gulf War, so he was my president then, he's since gone, this is about the men and women of Desert Storm. Let us honor them with gratitude, let us comfort the families of the fallen, and remember each life lost. Let us learn from them as well, and honor those who have served by serving others. Let us honor them as individuals, men and women of every race, every creed, all colors, by setting the face of this nation against discrimination, bigotry, and hate. Let's eliminate that. He went on to say, Americans are caring people, and I know that from living in Westfield. We are good people, generous people. Let us all be caring and good and generous in what we do. In closing, I want to thank you for letting me share some of my experiences of the Gulf War and thoughts on Memorial Day to veterans. I encourage you not only to remember those that we honor today at this ceremony, but please keep in mind our service members who are deployed and defending our freedom, and families in your thoughts and prayers. God bless you, God bless the United States of America, and to those who have made the ultimate sacrifice for our freedom. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Job well done. And now I would like to introduce our local officials, starting with the mayor of the city of Westfield, Mr. Michael McCabe.
I'm not sure how I follow that, Kathy. Thank you. It's super great to be here on behalf of the city of Westfield. I'm proud to be standing before you, and I'm proud to be here to honor our military veterans. Over to my right, though, I am going to introduce this line of folks. Whether or not they have speaking parts, I don't really know. Senator John Vilas, Representative Kelly Pease, our Gold Star Councilwoman Cindy Harris, Bridget Matthews Kane, Ward 3, Ward 1, Nick Morganelli, Albert Mascadrelli, Fire Commissioner, Ward 6, Mr. William Maniski, and Ward 4, Mr. Mike Burns. And last but not least, don't worry, we got you, Mary. We're going to get to you. We just don't know where you fit quite in yet, so we got you. Also, out and about throughout the common, there are many, many volunteer commissioners. Now, I don't know where they are, but I know the entire police commission was here. I believe I see Richie Seipek. I know that Judge Peter Vilas was here, and Jimmy Irwin is here. If there are any other commission members out there that I can't see, thank you for your voluntary service. We appreciate what you do. And Julie, really? How about this weather? Did you do this? Congratulations. Thank you. So I'm going to be brief. I have prepared some written comments, so I'm going to kind of stick with the script. Because as you know, I do get a little choked up at these events, so I apologize. Welcome, everybody, elected officials, family, friends, honored guests, and of course, our servicemen and women. And to those men and women who have gone before us, specifically Donald Raymond Gustafson. I'm going to get it right this time. Peter E. McCabe, Sr., without whom I wouldn't have a family. I see Jennifer McCabe out there in the back. Thank you for being there. So I'm going to offer you this poem that was written last year by Randall W. West. Fragile is a single life. The brave so freely give. Bound for immortality, their souls shall surely live. Death, don't be proud for who you took. They freely gave away. Their quest for freedom far outweighed the fear that you convey. They joined the ranks of warriors, staying vigil day and night. They often skipped a meal or two, but they never missed a fight. God bless the men and women whose fighting days are done. Say a special prayer at night for each and every one. Rest assured that you will find throughout the coming years, these fallen warriors will return in the hearts of all their peers. If we forget their sacrifice, their death will be in vain. Let us stand beside their loved ones as we sing their last refrain. You have come upon heaven's gate. You surely won't have long to wait. The saints will take good care of you, but there is still a lot to do. You have joined the ranks of everyone who fought so freedom could be won. Although your job on here on earth is done, your work in heaven has just begun. To the families and the friends who are here today, I wish you peace and comfort with the memories you share as you reflect the meaning of the day. To the members of our service people here and throughout the globe defending our freedom, we wish you Godspeed. Complete your mission and pray for your safe return. And recognize it is our duty as good citizens of these United States to make sure you are welcome home. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McCabe. Next, I would like to introduce our Massachusetts State Senator, Mr. John Viles. Mr. Viles.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. When we were back at MedTech getting ready to start the parade, a reporter came up to me and he said, "I have my first question for you is, you know, I've heard from a few people today that Westfield does it right. We've got this parade. We've got the 104th. We've got scouts. We've got every veterans group conceivable. We've got folks from the community. We've got kids. So how about a round of applause for Westfield?" Here we are again at another Memorial Day, which I know you've all heard me say, in my humble estimation and opinion, is without a doubt the most sacred day of the year. I think I've said this story to you before, but I'm gonna say it again because to me it brings it all home for what this day, the true meaning of this day is all about, as far as I'm concerned. On my last deployment to Afghanistan in 2018, I was leaving country from a place called BAF, Bagram Airfield. And when you went to the outgoing PAX terminal and you walk up a set of stairs, there's a mural, a picture. The picture could only be seen by people who are leaving the country for good. In other words, their deployment was over. They weren't traveling in country. They weren't going home on leave. Their deployment was over. And that was very purposeful. And you see the line backing up. And you see service members, myself included, getting tears in their eyes. And you walk up to it, and you see that mural, and it says, "This mural is dedicated to those who lost their lives in Operation Enduring Freedom. Live a life worthy of their sacrifice." And I'm convinced, at least it was for me, that the reason you see people pause, the reason that line is backing up, is because all of the service members who are leaving the country for good on that deployment, the realization is hitting them. I am going home, but everybody is not. And today, we're not honoring those who went home. Today, we're not honoring those ones who are still in. Today, we are honoring those who never were able to change out of their uniform for that last time. The ones who left it all on the battlefield. The ones who died so we could be here today. I hate cliches, but I'm going to say it anyway. They say that a veteran is that person who writes that blank check for an amount of up to and including their life. Today we don't honor them. Today we honor those where that check was cashed. I think it's really important, and I've got my one-year-old son here, and I think it's really important that we say their names. And I know everybody in this crowd has their names. But I'm gonna give you my names. Staff Sergeant Christopher Ward from Tennessee. KIA April 6, 2013. He was an absolute fitness freak. Nicest kid in the world with that Southern charm. Every time I saw him, "Good morning, sir. How's your day?" killed in action. Sergeant Robles, KIA, April 6, 2013. On April 5, 2013, I had the privilege of playing in a pickup basketball game against him at our FOB Smart in Kalat City in Afghanistan. All he wanted to talk about was his two kids. KIA, the next day. Sergeant Delphin Santos from California. Of the three, he's the one I knew the least. But I do recall he had a smile, an infectious smile. I know everybody here has got stories about their friends, their loved ones. But I think it's really, really important to say their names. And the reason I think it's important to say their names is because I think when tragedy hits, everybody's there for support. But then life moves on, let's be honest. For these family members, every single day is Memorial Day. For their loved one that they're never gonna get back, every day is Memorial Day. Finish with this. You know, we live in a crazy country. Certifiably lost his mind at points, I'm convinced. All this back and forth that we have in our country, all the time, let's just never forget that that crazy back and forth that is so often useless back and forth. We're able to do that because some young man, some young woman decided to raise their hand and say, I'll go serve. I'll go serve. So next time we're engaging in some of that less than great behavior, let's just remember the names and on the backs who we're doing that for. Most sacred day of the year. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Velez. Now I would like to introduce State Representative Mr. Kelly Pease.
Thank you, Gary. Thanks, Kathy, for your fine words. And everybody always says, when I get up to give a speech, you got to follow that. And I do. I have to follow the senator just about anywhere we go in Westfield. But you know what? I might not be quite as eloquent as the senator, but I am honored that he is my senator because as a fellow Army guy, you don't get much better than that. But today, as it's already been spoken, so I'm going to be brief as I usually am, that take time during your picnics, in your family time, to just think of those who have sacrificed, the ultimate sacrifice, you know, from all the way back to Lexington, Gettysburg, the trenches in France, D-Day, Chosin Valley in Korea, the Tet Offensive in Vietnam, Desert Storm, Operation Enduring Freedom, Iraqi Freedom, and many other little conflicts and skirmishes where we've lost soldiers and military members. So let's make sure we take a little moment of silence, as the fine lieutenant colonel said, and enjoy this. And again, I couldn't ask to live in a better community where we are a community and we support our veterans. So God bless and have a great day.
Thank you, Mr. Pease. Thank you for your time and your support for all veterans in our city and state to be veterans strong. Guests, please rise. Officer and Day, put all units at attention.
Commanders, bring your units to attention.
At this time, will the unit commanders please assemble at the World War II monument to my left and bring out the veterans' wreath to the base of our flagpole in the center of our park. After the wreath presentation, return to your units. Today's music selection will be With Honor We Serve, being performed on the bagpipes by Freddie Benda from American Legion Post 124.
Commanders, to your post.
I would also like to let everyone know that Mr. Freddie Benda donated all these poppy wreaths you see on the stones out here. Please take time at the end of the ceremony to look at them. There's dates on them for time and history. Thank you. Now, I would like to bring out the flag detail front and center. This will be performed today by Sherry Ambrose and Joe Ganault from American Legion 124. Officer Day, put troops at ease. Officer of the Day, take charge and prepare American Legion Post 124 rifle detail and followed by the plain four-part harmony taps by Westfield High School Alumni Band Trumpet Quartet led by Steve White, who is also a member of American Legion Post 124.
Commanders, bring your units to attention. Sergeant at arms, fire three volleys of rifle fire.
Port, ready, stay.
Guests, please be seated. Officer of the day, put all units at rest.
Commanders, take charge of your units and put them at rest.
Most Americans have seen the traditional folding of the American flag, a specific event such as funerals. Have you ever wondered why Oh Glory is flown in the specific ways? Much more than just pomp and circumstances, each of the 13 folds holds special meaning. The flag itself. The portion of the flag denoting honor in the canon of blue containing the stars, representing states of our veterans served in uniform. The fields of blue dress from left to right, and it's inverted only when draped as a funeral cloth over the casket of a veteran who has served our country honorably in uniform in the U.S. Armed Forces. At the ceremony of retreat, the flag is lowered, folded in a triangle, and kept under watch throughout the night as a tribute to our nation's honored dead. The next morning, it is brought out as at the ceremony of reveille, flown high as a symbol of belief in the resurrection of the body. The meaning behind the 13 folds. The flag folding ceremony represents the same religious principles on which our great country was originally founded. The first fold of our flag is a symbol of life. The second fold is a symbol of our belief in eternal life. The third fold is made in honor and remembrance of the veterans departing our ranks and who gave a portion of his or her life for the defense of our country to attain peace throughout the world. The fourth fold represents our weaker nature as American citizens trusting in God. It is him who we turn to in times of peace, as well as in times of war, for his divine guidance. The fifth fold is a tribute to our country. In the words of Stephen DeCour, our country is dealing with other countries. May she always be right, but it is still our country, right or wrong. The sixth fold is for where our hearts lie. It is with our heart that we pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The seventh fold is a tribute to our armed forces, for it is through the armed forces that we protect our country and our flag against all enemies. whether they be found within or without the boundaries of our republic. The eighth fold is a tribute to the one who entered into the valley of shadow of death, that we might see the light of day and honor our mother, for whom it flies on Mother's Day. The ninth fold is a tribute to womanhood. It has been through their faith, love, loyalty, and devotion that has molded the character of the men and women who have made this country great. The tenth fold is a tribute to Father, who has also given his son and daughters for the defense of our country since he or she was first born. The 11th fold represents the lower portion of the seal of King David and King Solomon and glorifies God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The 12th fold represents an emblem of eternity and glorifies God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. The 13th and last fold. When the flag is completely folded, the stars are upmost, reminding us of our national motto, "In God We Trust." After the flag is completely folded and tucked in, it has an appearance of a cocked hat, ever reminding us of the soldiers who served under General George Washington, and the sailors and Marines who served under Captain John Paul Jones, and were followed by their comrades and shipmates in the U.S. Armed Forces, preserving for us the rights, privileges, and freedoms we enjoy today. The source and the date of this origin for the flag folding procedures is unknown. However, some sources attribute it to the Gold Star Mother of America, while others to an Air Force chaplain stationed at the United States Air Force Academy. Some sources are indicated that the 13 folds are a nod to the original first 13 colonies. The flag folding ceremony is provided as a patriotic service. At this time, presenting the flag to our Kathy Martin, Lieutenant Commander, to receive Old Glory. Ma'am. Now, at this time, I would like to have Mr. Freddie Benda will perform "Lest We Forget" on his bagpipes. Sir? Thank you again, Mr. Frey Bendo. At this time, I would like to thank all the individuals and organizations that have helped put this ceremony together. Without your time and assistance, this event would not have taken place. JP Lighting and Sound Systems, Ms. Julie Barnes, who is Westfield Veterans Representative, and going above and beyond for our city and our veterans. Julie. For veteran organization representation in Westfield, our Veterans Westfield Council, the Rifle Detail, Post 124, Post 124 Auxiliary, Post 124 Sons of the American Legion, Post 124 Legion Riders, and Post 124 BSA Scouts. The young Marines and their leaders, the Westfield Marine Corps League, Detachment 141, the Vietnam Veterans, Chapter 219, the Coast Guard Auxiliary, the Merchant Marines, the Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts of America, the Purple Heart Trail Foundation, the Westfield Elks, the 104th Honor Guard, Mass State Police, and the Mass Sheriff's Division, the VFW 872 from Southwick, all our branches of the U.S. military and their families, the Westfield Fire Department and Police Department, and especially to the many volunteers who are behind the scenes making events happen. And to everyone who attended today, thank you for coming out for this ceremony. I also want to thank the Westfield Gas and Electric for all the banners when you're driving down through town. Please look up. There's veterans banners out there that represent all our past veterans that serve for your town and your country. Right now, due to illness, Lori Greenlee from the Vietnam Veterans Chapter 219 will not be with us today due to COVID. So please come forward, Richie Olekna from Post 124 for our benediction.
Let us pray. O God, almighty and merciful, we remember before you in this moment our departed comrades. We recall with reverence the good deeds they accomplished. We honor these beloved who fought a good fight in a just cause, comrades both in war and in peace, who have served the country with dignity and honor. May they rest in peace. May we consecrate our hearts and lives to you and to our country, and to the ideals and principles and hopes of those whom we honor, who have served faithfully and are now at rest. Amen.
Thank you, Richie.
Officer of the day, put all troops at attention.
All units, come to attention.
As we depart, I want to leave you with some thoughts. Learn history, preserve our history, understand our history. Make and remember history. Right now, I would like to thank everybody who's here today. God bless a beautiful day. God bless America, and God bless our country. Officer today, take charge, dismiss the troops and the guests.
Commanders, take charge of your units and dismiss them.
Thank you.